If you don't know me, my name's Rebecca Scott. I'm a lecturer at WEDC at Loughborough University. So welcome from me personally, welcome on behalf again of the WEDC team. And I'm facilitating this session or moderating this session with the help of David Galibourg, who you can see, if you want to wave, don't I'll wave as well, wave to David. We're not in the same location. David is one of our PhD researchers. And together we are going to do our best to moderate this session. David, do you want to just say hello?
Yeah. Hi, everyone. Welcome in this session. And as Rebecca mentioned, if any of the presenters is joining, please let us know.
Yeah. We are both new to this system. So if we have little glitches along the way, please bear with us. I'm aware that you can't see any other attendees in your attendee box. It just shows that you're the only attendee. But that's why it's lovely to have people saying hello in the chat, because you get a sense that you're with a community of people. We can see that we have an increasing number of attendees now 19. I noticed people saying you can't hear me. Sorry, Alberto, you may need to change settings on your own system. If you're having technical problems, go back to the foyer, go to IT support, and they will help you out. There's not anything I can do from this side. Okay, so as I mentioned, we will continue to show presentations, even if the person who's made the recording isn't in the session yet. That's what we've agreed to do across the conference, and that will run throughout the week, the 3 days. So we will start with the recording from Deborah Muheka, looking at achieving ODF status at scale within Malawi and using behaviour change approaches combined with other particular interventions to try to achieve that. And rather nicely, I think, following on from Professor Biswas's opening plenary with a strong emphasis on perceptions and how we address challenges through changing behaviours, changing mindsets. I think that this is a lovely way to kind of start off looking at that specifically in sanitation systems and services. So if I manage to do this correctly, David, help me out if I do it wrong. I'm just going to start the first presentation. It's not the name on the program who's presenting. I don't see Panganani in our attendee list either, so we'll start the presentation, and then hopefully somebody may be here who's been involved in the project to answer questions. Okay, and if you do have a question, well, just a point of interest, we can see if we can have a more general discussion. Okay, so if all is well, I'll start this one running.
I'm going to take you through World Vision Malawi presentation. Did you know that out of 19 million Malawians, only 4.6 million have access to safely managed sanitation facilities? Did you know that about 853,000 people in Malawi are still practicing open defecation? As WASH practitioners, we all know that achieving SDG 6.2 continues to be a major challenge facing the WASH sector. A creative solution are needed to adapt the tools that World Vision Malawi and the other partners are doing for great impact. World Vision is one of the key partners working with government to implement sanitation and hygiene interventions. And we would like to share with you today the learnings from the unique brand of the interventions that World Vision has done. World Vision employ unique approaches and models in implementing the sanitation and hygiene. One of the approaches that World Vision used the community territorial sanitation. This is one of the main approach that World Vision Malawi employed. And this approach was going hand in hand with the design of behavior change and care group model, as well as the sanitation marketing. During the CLTS or the approach, all frontline staffs were capacitated on how to use the model. And from there, the areas that had challenges in terms of the specific behavior issues is where we employed the design for behavior change. And the design for behavior change worked hand in hand with the care group model, because the care group model members were the ones that were going to each and every household to ensure that the behaviors that were identified were addressed. And from there, we also employ the sanitation marketing. And looking at the approaches that World Vision used, CLTS was used at the demand creation approach. And that one is where people were demanding for the sanitation services. And on the sanitation marketing, it is where the supply of the sanitation services were also done. So that chain that chain of the activities or of the modules helped Road Vision Malawi to achieve the sanitation hygiene strides at scale. And apart from that, World Vision also engaged the partners like faith leaders and local leaders in doing the CLTS approach and the design for behavior change. The community members were empowered to conduct the monitoring and to collect the sanitation and hygiene data. And also the frontline government staff were also capacitated. Care group model is one of the government road model. And this model usually uses the door-to-door approach with high frequency of messaging. As you can see in this table, each care group has got a promoter. And a promoter oversees 2 to 3 care groups. And each and every care groups has got a membership of 8 to 12. And it is this care group membership or care group members that goes and verify each and every household to ensure that it has got all the basic sanitation facilities. And also if there are issues of a specific behavior that that household or that community needs to be conducted, and it's this care group model members that went there to see and support the households in the selected communities. Yeah, from triggering, we go to CLTS follow-ups. And in Malawi, we usually conduct 3 to 4 CLTS follow-ups. The first follow-ups usually is used as a benchmark or a baseline where we know the number of households that have got latrines. And the second follow-ups, we noticed how many latrines have been constructed since the first follow-up. Once it is achieved 100%, we call upon the district coordination team to conduct verification. Once the district coordination team satisfied with the results or satisfied that the committee has or the traditional authority has 100% open defecation free, they call upon the National ODEP Task Force team, which they also confirm if they have satisfied that the area has been declared ODF. So once the area has been confirmed is when we have the ODF celebrations. 42% of all traditional authorities in Malawi are certified open defecation free. Out of these TAs, 19% of these TAs were done by World Vision from 2017 to 2022. and 78% of the traditional authorities are within the World Vision implementation areas. And looking at the baseline, and evaluation information that was conducted by World Vision Malawi, it was noted that there is increase in the proportion of households using improved sanitation from 57.9 to 78%. This has been attributed due to the effort and the unique brains of the models that World Vision Malawi used. From the implementation of the sanitation hygiene project, World Vision Malawi has learned that the promotion of sanitation and behavior change needs to be holistic, integral, and participatory, addressing both supply and demand. And it has also noted that involvement of local leaders, faith leaders, and care group, and also partnering with the government and other partners, has really contributed a lot in achieving the ODF in Malawi. And this also involving different behavior change approaches have also contributed to the milestone that Malawi as a nation has achieved. Apart from that, there is some notable challenges that we have experienced over the past years. There was inadequate sector financing from the government, and this has really affected the sanitation, the WASH sector. For example, in the FY21, FY22 financial year budget, only 2% of the total budget were allocated to WASH. And there's also lack of political will to support intervention by the members of parliament. And the universal access to sanitation and ending open defecation requires a collaboration with partners, community, and unique blend of demand creation and supply intervention. This is what I had for you this morning, this afternoon, wherever you are. Thank you for your listening.
Okay, well, thank you very much, Panganani, if you're watching this at some point in the future, for that interesting presentation. I'm still not aware that we have anybody from the project as an attendee. There are a number of questions and some interesting questions to do with the nature of the care groups themselves, how they're financed, what types of visits they make, and also the sanitation technologies that are being promoted. I think my first question is to any of the attendees who are here, are you, if anyone is familiar with the programme or applying the same approach in another context, if you want to let us know, then we can give you the floor to put your camera on and your microphone and to inform us. But I think unfortunately we don't have people necessarily directly from there. Okay, I'm aware somebody still can't hear me, Alberto, who won't be able to hear me say that.
Sorry, yes, Alberto, did you try to go out and come back in? And every people who have audio issues, that could be enough. In the meantime, if one of the presenters is here and cannot hear us, could they do the same so that we can allow them to answer some of the questions?
Yeah. Okay, we have a hand raised from Patricia. So if you do want to, David, like to give Patricia the floor, we can invite you to put on your camera and your microphone, or one or the other. And then you can join us in the little box at the top here and contribute. Patricia, we can see you just.
Okay, just a quick one. Thank you so much. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, thank you so much to the presenter. Just a quick question is, how do you define open defecation free status? My experience in Uganda is that the calculation or definition for open defecation free is very complicated, and as a result, there we may not attain that by 2030. So how is it in Malawi? Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Patricia. If you just want to mute, because there's some background sound. As you'll be aware, we don't have the presenters from the program, so actually here. So I'm not familiar with myself with what the definitions are for OGF status in Malawi, but I am very aware that definitions are very different throughout different countries, and indeed sometimes through different programs in those different countries. So we would just to be aware that the sessions are being recorded, so it may be possible that the presenters, if they watch this in the future, they can put some answers up, or if you go to the cafe in the breaks, if you're able to find them or message the presenters, then you can ask your question to them directly. Okay, I'm aware there's another hand up that may be the same. Patricia, maybe if you lower your hand, I'll see if there's another person who has the hand raised. No, it's not another. Oh. Okay. I have lost sight of who everybody is, and I've lost my co-presenter. Okay. So sorry, I'm not able to address any of your questions directly. I can't see the presenter list anymore. I went to the raised hand. Okay, hopefully you're all still here. I'm going to move on to the next presentation. And see if, let me just see if I can get back to the list of participants. No, sorry. Amans, if you're here, you'll have to type in the chat box, or if anyone from this presentation is here, please also do the same, and then we can take your any questions after this presentation. But yeah, apologies, David, I've lost sight of all of the participants. I went to the raised hand list, and I've lost the full list of people.
So okay.
So, sorry, I was saying I'm not aware that we've got anyone from this second presentation, but I'll run the presentation. And if you can keep an eye on who's in the attendee list, because I've lost that. Great, thank you. Okay, so we're now going to hear about improving households. Oh, great, I have the list back. Improving household sanitation and hygiene in DRC through a community health club approach. So I'll start the presentation, and then if anyone has not only questions but any contributions to make, then we can take those in the time afterwards. Okay.
Warm greetings all. My name is Amans Ntakarutimana from the University of Rwanda. I'm going to present a case study conducted in the Democratic Republic of Congo as a case study to improve household hygiene and sanitation practices. was conducted 2014, 2015, and it was a partnership between the local leaders, the Minister of Health, represented by the BCZ, Fizi Health Zone, and Tier Fund, which is a UK organization, but also Africa Head, which is also a UK organization. The case study was conducted as an essay to see if it can be good for scale up. The case study consists of the implementation of community health club approach, and it targeted the 26 villages as a case study. And the community health club intervention approach consists of a weekly health education targeting household representatives, and in each of the 26 villages was having a weekly meeting with household representatives for WASH education. After each session of WASH education, there was an assignment known as recommended practices, where each household representative has to go and help the household to achieve the recommended practices, if it is a latrine, if it is a hand washing facility, if it is in the, if it is drinking water treatment. It was a recommended practice which was given after each session of WASH education. And each WASH education session had a topic to cover. Then there was at each village a community health worker to facilitate the WASH education, but also the community health club committee to monitor if household have implemented the recommended practices. There was also a supervision by the community health supervisor to see if the sessions are going on as planned. Then at the end, because it was an essay, there was a need to know if the intervention is promising for scale up. To assess that, a baseline was conducted by the implementers before the start of the intervention. And also at the end of the intervention, there was an endline survey, which consists of assessing the household sanitation hygiene practices. A secondary data collection, which focused on cases of reported WASH-related disease. This disease included diarrhea, cholera, schistosomiasis, amebiasis, but also there was a malaria which was included. The secondary data collection was conducted in four health centers serving the region, the intervention area. Those health centers provided data before the intervention and provide data also after the intervention, but considering the same zone in 2014 and the same period in 2014 and same period in 2015. The result from the two kind of data collection, the household surveys showed a good increase of sanitation and the hygiene practices at household level, where we could see clean latrine has improved, as a practice has improved of 29%. Hand washing practice, it increased of 91%, and so on and so on, which is a good increase of sanitation and hygiene practices at household level. In terms of wash-related disease, the secondary data collection also showed that there was a big reduction of wash-related disease, where cholera was reduced at 44%, and diarrhea was reduced at 83%, and so on, which is a good reduction, which satisfied the health zone during the evaluation, and they declared that the approach is the best compared to what they have been doing. Also, we noted the correlation between the attendance at village level of household representatives to the meetings and the performance of household in terms of sanitation and hygiene practices. This means for a village with a high attendance of high attendance of household representatives to the education session, the same village had also a high performance of household. It means a high number of household with sanitation and hygiene practices implemented. This is a sign of the power of the intervention, because we know not all people are always active to implement what they learn. Then here we can see that the involvement of heads of village to mobilize people, the involvement of the committee at village level to assess or to visit, to monitor if the household are implementing the recommended practices, but also the involvement of local artisans, as you see on the picture, local artisans and the local masons helped household to achieve the recommended practices, but also the mutual assistance helped to support the vulnerable household. Then those strategies, among others, helped household to implement sanitation and hygiene practices. Finally, we can say that the intervention was successful and contributed to the improvement of sanitation and hygiene practices, but also contributed to the reduction of wash-related disease. This is something which can be, if possible, repeated in comparison to the existing interventions to see what can work best. This is the end of my presentation. I thank you so much for your attention.
Okay, great presentation. Amans, it looks as though you're here with us, which is great. Your surname is spelt slightly differently in the attendee list, so I hope it's you. So we can invite you to join us in the little audio, the visual block in the corner, And then you can take some questions. So if you'd like to accept, if you're happy to accept joining us with your camera or your audio, either or both, that would be great. We'll just wait to see what's... Is that in process, David? Okay. So Tom, hello Tom, long time no see, with a question relating to people's experience of setting up or running these community health clubs. I'm aware they're not very widely used. They were being used, trying to think where it was, is it in Uganda? Initially, and then they were rolling out into Rwanda later on. I'm aware the project was from 2015, so there may be other programs since then. But it would be great to hear more from Amans.
We're trying to reach out, but I don't know if it's not working or something. There was also another question by Alex. Before explaining about the approach, can we have a baseline sanitation hygiene condition? Okay, let me try something else then.
Can we make Amanda a presenter?
Yes, I'm trying that.
Okay, yes, great.
So now Amans is a presenter with us, but yes, he seemed to still not be able to activate his microphone or camera. Maybe in the meantime, trying to answer the question in the chat box. You're muted, Rebecca, I think. Rebecca, if you're talking to us, I think you're muted.
I'm so sorry. Yeah. Oh dear, statement of the century. Just to say that the actual results in terms of reductions in certain health conditions, disease, diarrheal diseases, cholera, malaria, etc., and also from improvements in certain practices and presence of certain facilities are in the extended abstract, if you wanted to have a look at those as well. I was also interested in what the starting point was, the baseline from which those results were derived. So if Amans, you're able to provide any more information on where those communities were at in terms of rates of access and use of safe sanitation water facilities and hand washing facilities. That would be, that would help to address Alex's questions. And there was also a question around the current status of the community health clubs. You're saying it's now a countrywide approach. If it's being adopted and widely used, that's lovely to hear. And are those interventions achieving the same level of same types of results that you were seeing back in 2015? And whether the reality of COVID-19 has made a marked difference in the approach or in the results that you're seeing, that you're aware of. So perhaps some questions, Amans, for you to consider and type your answers. If you want to just expand a little bit more on some of the issues. Perhaps in the meantime, as that might take you some time to type, we can move on to the next presentation. We do have the presenter with us. So at the end of the presentation, we can have some time for questions. If you've still got questions for Amans, continue to put them in the chat, and he'll have to type as much as he can to answer, or meet in the cafeteria afterwards. Okay, so is that okay if we move on to the final presentation? I'm checking with David, my co-host. I think we're okay to do that. Okay, super. But do keep using the chat. Okay, so the final third presentation, looking at behaviour change communication in relation to faecal sludge management services. So presumably moving from more rural to urban contexts. So I'll run the presentation. It's a shorter one, 5 minutes, I can see. And we have... I'm sorry, I don't know your first name because we only have your initial N, Abilas Asha, with us, who will be able to answer questions afterwards.
Hi everyone, I'm Abilas Asha from the Indian Institute for Human Settlements in India. I'm a specialist from the Tamil Nadu Urban Sanitation for FSN. TNSSP, launched in 2015, is the technical support unit to the state government of Tamil Nadu to improve urban sanitation and scale FSM across 663 towns in the state. TNSSP has actively engaged with multiple sanitation stakeholders to ensure that there is a strong buy-in for FSM by establishing the required institutional frameworks. To sustain this, TNSSP adopted to BCC as a pathway to develop ownership of improved sanitation among all stakeholders. This slide highlights the gaps in the full cycle of sanitation when the program was launched in 2015. While the establishment of necessary infrastructure is an important first step to close these gaps, their effective utilization and sustainability depends upon the uptake by various stakeholders along the chain. To move towards this, TNUSSP adopted to BCC rather than IEC to focus on changing existing behavior or inculcating new ones through a series of materials and nudges or interactive experiences. Given the multitude of stakeholders along the full cycle, segmenting and targeting of audiences was an important exercise. There was a need for evoking the benefits of new behavior and informing about the dangers of continuing the status quo, and thereby positioning safe sanitation as something which is aspirational. TNUSSP's strategy had three objectives for three different audiences. Given that sanitation is a taboo topic, predominantly in India, there was a need to normalize talking about sanitation and bringing it out of the closet. Sanitation as a topic campaign was designed for the same. Furthermore, it was important for the local governments to recognize the full cycle of sanitation, to regulate and enforce rules. Advocacy of septage management campaign was aimed at this. Finally, there was a need to give special attention to vulnerable stakeholders. Valorizing sanitary workers campaign was envisaged for the same. Specific campaigns were designed under these umbrella campaigns. Under these campaigns, TNSSP recognized the need for a targeted and focused communication. Hence, the strategy mapped various target groups along the food cycle and developed relevant key messages for their awareness and call to action. Based on the strategic approach, the Kakaman campaign was developed. A friendly mascot called Kakaman or Shipman was developed through an iterative process as shown. The campaign was pre-tested in 2017, but operational constraints hindered its statewide launch. The Kakaman campaign was developed in two phases. The first phase was designed to introduce the audience to the full cycle of sanitation and the upcoming FSM infrastructure in the state. The second phase of the campaign aimed to disseminate detailed messaging focusing on call to actions on containment, emptying, treatment and disposal. The campaign also had a musical film explaining the full cycle to the audience in a fun manner.
வெட்ட வெளியில போனா வெக்க கேடுன்னு வீட்டுக்குள்ளே டாய்லெட் கட்டி வச்சேன். நீங்களா போய் தங்கறதுக்கு செப்டிக் டேங்க் கட்டி வச்சிருக்கேன். வேற என்னடா பண்றது?
செப்டிக் டேங்க் கட்டி சோலையெல்லாம் முடிச்சு சுகமா இருந்தீங்களே. பரிச ரெண்டும் ஆற பின்னு வண்டி ஏத்தி அனுப்பி வைக்க மறந்து போனீங்களே. கக்கா மேன் இப்ப பக்கா மேன், கக்கா மேன் இப்ப பக்கா மேன்.
கக்கா மேன் கேம்பெயின் வாஸ் லான்ச் டு அ டிஜிட்டல் கேம்பெயின் ஆன் வேர்ல்ட் வாட்டர் டே 2020. As the campaign gained momentum, it was developed into a full-fledged BCC campaign, including above-the-line and below-the-line modes for the statewide and city-level launch. The campaign was piloted in the city of Trichy in February 2021. To conclude, here are some learnings from our experience. The preparedness of local governments is key for successful implementation of BCC campaigns. This includes securing funds, building capacity of campaign anchors, and the availability of pre-tested tools for campaign planning. Though piloted in 2021, the statewide launch was reprioritized due to external factors enlisted in this slide. However, TNUSSP is working towards taking these lessons into the statewide rollout alongside the government. We welcome questions and suggestions. You can also visit our website to know more about our work. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Abelasha. You're here. I love that video clip. I'd like to see more. can we make Abelasha join us in the audio so we can ask you some questions? Hooray! It can work. Fantastic. Welcome.
Hello. Am I audible?
Thank you for your... Yes, we can hear you. That's okay. Brilliant. And thank you for your... for your presentation, that was wonderful. I think there's already a couple of questions for you, which you may have seen in the chat. So one was that I think they're all related to the people wearing the wonderful Kakaman suits. The first one is relating to how those people kind of experience being part of the process. The question is, how did they experience the journey? I assume that means in terms of the kind of change of approach and the change of means of communicating, not a physical journey, but a kind of mindset journey. So if you have anything to add about the sense of the people who were taking on those roles, that would be great.
Myself and my colleague Niladri is also here. So we have tried to answer the questions. Kakaman is more of a mascot. And initially when the pre-testing of Kakaman was going on, we did have people wearing the robes. You would have seen in the video. But soon after that, we kind of shifted it to this digital mascot, which we developed. And we're taking ahead the campaign with that mascot. So it is not pertaining to one particular person with so-and-so features. It's more of a cartoon kind of character, a mascot, which is neutral character, which is taking forward these FSM related key messages as part of our BC states BCC campaign to the stakeholders. So that is the approach. What you saw in the film was the initial pre-testing and the film audio video part of it. After that, it's transitioned into the mascot based campaign.
And that is proving to be more receptive from your audience. Do you find, or you can, is that the intention of that is to reach a much larger audience, I guess?
Yeah.
Feedback of what would be preferable means of communicating.
Yes, we both at the pre-testing, we found that the especially the name Kakaman, which literally translates to shipman, was very well received from the audiences, especially children. They were quite fascinated about this, and it is a very friendly looking character, which takes the whole idea of this being very approachable and something. Sanitation is a topic which, you know, can be an everyday topic, something which is not scary and something which we all need to speak about. So that was the intention when we were developing this very friendly looking mascot called Kakaman to take these key messages. Very well received, especially among children.
Right. Yes, I can imagine. There's another question, Abalasha, from Anwesha D. About the pricing of desludging services. So how was that established?
Yes, so in Tamil Nadu, the desludging market is a thriving private market, and largely it is not governed by, like, because it is a private market, there is localized rates, and the program or the government is not trying to, of course, we're trying to regularize it, but it's only a light touch model. And so the desludging is largely by the private market. So it's not us working out the prices. We are just trying to regulate the existing market so that, you know, we don't invade the model. But so it is, that's the model which we are following in the state.
Yes. So it's not part of your program defining those prices. That's already established.
Yes.
By the state. But just as a quick follow-up question for me, is that is that what you were referring to, a scheduled desludging, or it's an on-demand?
It's an on-demand model, and we do have this regulation model of I also see another question in the chat, so I'm going to try and answer together. Yeah. So there are these designated fecal sludge treatment plants which are coming up in the state, and also the state is practicing co-treatment at some of the STPs, sewage treatment plants. So what we have here is the cluster model, in which a cluster of urban local bodies within 10 kilometers from the treatment facilities share this treatment plant through a very simple memorandum of understanding between the ULBs, and the desludging operators are also licensed and they're registered with these ULBs. So that's the kind of regulatory model which we're trying to do to ensure that the ULBs within the 10 kilometer radius do have access to these facilities, as well as the operational maintenance of these plants are taken care of. So that is kind of the model here.
Yeah. Okay. Oh, I was going to ask a question, but I see another one. So there's a question from Alex. After the campaign, in what way have you been monitoring the outcomes and impact?
The campaign was launched, it was pre-tested earlier around 2017-18, and we did get a buy-in from the state government as well as for launching a statewide campaign, but unfortunately we were amidst the COVID pandemic. So as of now, a pilot was done in the city of Trichy in Tamil Nadu. And we are hoping for a statewide campaign sometime this year, as soon as the situation, the COVID situation permitting. So after the full-fledged campaign, we do have monitoring and the need for an impact assessment in place. But then we need to see, because we are still waiting for the full-fledged statewide rollout. That is where we are. And it, that also goes on to show the operational constraints we have in running these behavior change communication campaigns real time, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah. So that's another lesson we got from this whole exercise.
Okay. If I'm just keeping an eye up on other questions, so do keep them coming in if you have them. While we're waiting for any other questions, is there interest from other states in the process and in asking how it could be adopted elsewhere?
Yes, absolutely. So here in India, we have a National Fecal Sludge Management Alliance, and there are similar campaigns running in other states in India. While Kakaman is a unique approach to which Tamil Nadu has taken, because it is a very context-specific character which was developed for the state. And of course, it is a replicable model, because the messages are very generic, as well as specific call to actions are there in the campaign. So it is a package which is available, and it is definitely replicable. And similar models are happening across the states in India.
Okay. Great, thank you. And any questions from our participants? You can raise your hand or chat in the box. David, do you have a question?
No, I saw one, but it's probably answered now. I wish asking if the government was trying to regularize the practice. That's what you just indicated. And the question from Alex that maybe related earlier. After the campaign, in what way have you monitored the outcomes or impact?
Yeah, I think you've addressed those. There's some responses. Abilesia, I was interested to know whether your messaging is linking into other campaign messages around sort of safer environments, the cleanliness of the environment, very much part of the clean sanitation campaign, or Clean India campaign, sorry. Are you aligning your messaging with others looking at water security, water safety, safe environments, so forth? And we'll come to the next question.
Yes, absolutely. First, the messaging is of two phases, and in the first phase, we are actually informing the people that, you know, a safe environment or access to a safe sanitation is not just about toilets. So we introduced a full cycle of sanitation and tell them that this is has larger linkages to public health and you know, environmental safety. And then in the second phase of the campaign, we go into the roles and responsibilities and call to action for each stakeholder, in which we do say that the designated place for dispersing the septage is the FSTP or the STP. So that is the right thing for the environment. So we don't get into too much of the technical details, because largely it is for general audiences, but we do touch upon the larger connects with the environment and the public health aspects, which is largely aligned to the Swachh Bharat mission, Clean India mission. It is linking to the larger narrative, but also specific to what is actually happening in the state, and very simple and generic messages so that everyone would comprehend and relate to it.
Yeah, okay, super, thank you. There is one other question. I think we have time if you're okay to answer this one, from Prerana. What other behavior change approaches have been adopted in Tamil Nadu, presumably within the WASH sector, if not within sanitation specifically?
I can tell about some other initiatives from our program, if that will be more relevant here. So one is this Kakaman campaign, which is kind of a holistic campaign for FSM for all stakeholders, but we do work closely with other stakeholder groups, and not in the campaign mode, but more about taking key messages on safe wash to school children, and also about health-seeking behavior and personal protective equipment, and the need to look at health and welfare for sanitation workers. We also work with sanitation worker communities in the sense to, you know, not just the sanitation workers, but also their families, to take this messaging to them. And we also have a set of interventions around menstrual health management, in which we again work with school children and children and women in the urban poor settlements. So yeah, these are some other areas in which our program is also intervening, not exactly in campaigns, but to take key messages to relevant stakeholders, because they're all intrinsically linked to FSM and safe sanitation.
Great. Okay, that's fabulous. Thank you. And it's so nice to finally be able to have direct responses to direct questions. I think we've covered all the questions for now, and we're coming to the end. Were there any final points you wanted to make, Abulasha, before we wrap up?
I think we have discussed. I would just like to post the link to our website on the chat, so in case if there are any further queries, we'd like to know more about our book. That's the page, and also our email ID, so that if there are any further queries, for you could always reach out to us.
Yes, lovely. Yeah. Okay. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
We'll let you disappear. So we'll end the session there.